practice of Sri Ramchandra's Raja Yoga and its efficacy by Sri K.C. Narayana. The word Raja Yoga is derived from the identifying the kingly thing in man. It is now well known that thought is the kingly thing in man. But this simple fact was first realized by a saint who lived about 80 generations before King Dasaratha, the father of the avatar Sri Rama. This becomes necessary to identify this mainly because man is essentially an animal as any other, but with two well-developed faculties of thinking, his reasoning, and capacity to express feelings. The word yoga means union, or rather feeling of union. Let us clearly understand that the root used in Sanskrit means to unite. In Raja Yoga, the feeling of union is what is aimed at through the process of thought. All forms of Raja Yoga are meant only for that. Yoga is union, and we are trying to use thought forces.
1 minute, sir. Upudu, in Raja Yoga, the feeling of union is what is aimed at through the process of thought. Upudu, neuroscience lo research prakaram emante. Suppose we are holding the thought of Babaji Maharaj in our mind for about, suppose for 1 hour you're holding the thought. So what happens, as long as you're holding this thought, there's a continuous reinterpretation and reorientation going on in the brain networks. And sinks into your unconscious, and it becomes a background of a feeling of Babaji Maharaj, actually. And that background feeling actually colors all your other thoughts, actually. And if it becomes very strong, then that becomes your reality, and then you're transformed. So the whole idea is we try to hold the same thought, and as long as you're holding, the brain is constantly changing. And it the thought actually goes into your unconscious, and there it becomes a feeling, and the feelings actually are very powerful. They color your perception, they color your cognition also. So in meditation, what we are trying to do is we are holding the thought of Babaji Maharaj for as long as is possible. As long as that we are holding the thought in the mind, your brain is constantly getting rewired and then aligning itself into that state. And if it has become strong in the subconscious mind, your job is done, actually. Yes, sir. We'll go ahead, sir.
Modern world has, apart from taking away all other things from us, has also taken away the thought process. The thought process is getting annihilated. Somebody else is thinking all the time for us. Let us warn ourselves against this onslaught on thought process and allow it to be not a casualty, because that is the kingly thing in man. That is the only distinguishing factor between animals and us. No other species has got this capacity. It is a special gift of God for us, a gift that we are now trying to squander away and allow somebody else to exploit it with whatever little mind he has got. He has got every right to say whatever he wants to say, just as we have every right to say whatever we want to say. But we are not here to get brainwashed. There are two words in tradition which I would like to use in this connection. A person who has got all other abharanas, ornaments, has got no value. But a person who has got jnana and vairagya is considered to be possessing very precious jnana vairagya bhushanam. Please note it. The most precious thing you can have is jnana, that is knowledge. And the greatest knowledge you can have is vairagya. Jnana does not mean ultimate or oneness with God, etc. jnana leads you to vairagya or a sense of detached functioning. Detached functioning and not renunciation of the houses and running away. Modern management tells us that when we are detached and do not subject ourselves to task, and when we look at it objectively, our performance is at its best, and it is no better wisdom than what our great rishis have already said. I am not going to say that the modern management is to be thrown away. It is absolutely essential that we should read that, follow that in order to be successful. The main point to stress is that it should be detached functioning. Madhava, anything to comment?
It's very clear, sir. No problem. The question is, we have to constantly spiritual development happens if you put appropriate questions.
Right.
So any research also, any innovation or creativity happens if you put the right questions actually. So if you are reading, we have to put a question to ourselves: has this detached functioning developed or not? So unless we put that question, we are not trying to probe into ourselves and then dive into our own being actually. So all people are listening, they should put this question honestly and then watch themselves whether this detached functioning is developing or not. Babaji claims that by the effort of practice of meditation on the divine light and with the support of pranahuti, this comes very quickly, he says. Is as per him, it's a preliminary achievement. So whether this preliminary achievement which Babaji claims has unfolded in ourselves, has resulted in others, the honest question has to be put at. So truth can be unpalatable, may not be pleasant, but then you have to face it. Truth is very important. Definitely it is unpalatable, but doesn't matter that by pampering our ego and trying to continue to remain in illusion that we are meditating and progressing will not do any good at all. We have to face the truth, even if it is unpalatable, and then only you can progress. Otherwise, we try to maintain illusion that we are all disciples of Babaji, our master is a special personality. So just think about him and just have... just believe that he's a great man and then automatically your mind will come under control. That is an illusion which ego tries to maintain, that illusion that you're great people just because your master is a great man. That doesn't help. He wanted that we should be liberated, and we have to put this question amongst us. I think that is, unless you put the question and face the issue honestly, we are not entered into the spiritual field at all.
Right, sir.
Mind you, this is a work in progress, but at least you starting questions, then we are moving in the correct direction. It comes with practice. It comes, we should know that we are moving on the correct path, and then we are moving, not stagnant at one place.
Jnana and Vairagya are possible only when we use the thought process. When we don't use our thought process, neither Jnana, knowledge and understanding, nor Vairagya, due attachment to actions, is there. Jnana is lost and you come to the level of a stupid. Vairagya is not there and we tend to get attached to every conceivable thing that is advertised. Yoga is union. As a gross reflection of this concept of a union, we started talking in terms of a family institution around 7,000 to 8,000 years back. Family as an institution started a distinguishing feature between animal and man. Animals do not have families, we have. Because we used the thought process earlier and we have found that living for ourselves doesn't make sense. sharing alone makes sense. It is on that principle of sharing we started living with others for a lifetime. If we do not have a sharing principle, and if marriage is only an institution for satisfying our physiological urges, it is bound to fail. This is a development in our thinking from our egocentric, selfish approach, which goes today by the name of independent approach, as against one of participation, cooperation, sacrifice, and service. Family as an institution is capable of meeting that demand. We started families, families grew bigger. We still continue to work with the old parents. Great grandfathers lived with their great grandchildren, not because they could afford such a big family, but because they had broadness of the heart by which they could share whatever little they had. When we don't compromise on our basic animal needs of either hunger or other basic physiological urges, we will not be in a position to live with others. When we sacrifice on these issues, we will be in a position to live together. This philosophy went further to accommodate the Atithi who comes to us without even informing, and we are ordained to sacrifice everything we have got to him. This is said to be the basis of family. This is further elaborated in the concept Atithi Devo Bhava. Treat the guest as God himself. After having said that, the mother, father and teacher are to be treated as gods in the Vedas and Upanishads. Thus, sacrifice and service have been upheld as the real values of life, and this is due to the thinking process that churned out this truth by the Vedic times. This is why when they said this is the dharma of a grihastha, they were trying to tell you what is the basis of family. When they indicated the guest as the most important person, as the God, they are sending you a message. Basically, the point we should remind ourselves in this present day polluted atmosphere that is not restricted to physical and atmosphere, but to the very thought process, is that it is our dharma to share even at the point of our deprivation. Those of us who know the story of the mongoose, often quoted by Swami Vivekananda, which exemplifies the glory of sacrifice of a poor teacher, will understand the glory of sacrifice and the duties to be performed when we are part of a family. Please note the extent to which we have been extorted by our tradition to live up to, and to what levels we have fallen. It is for us to decide. There is no point in decrying our present condition, but it is possible to live higher. In this land, we are told what is to share. It is the principle of sharing and sacrifice which has permitted us to allow every person to come and state whatever he wants to stay. It has been our bitter experience that we have been fooled in this subject thanks to the modern times. We have come to a stage wherein we are getting exploited, families are getting ruined, joint family system is gone, small family systems are becoming important. Unfortunately, even small families are also not continuing. The husband and wife have a difference and every alternative day they sue each other and they go for a divorce. A stage has come in the West wherein they have started thinking whether marriage is required at all. They developed a concept of staying together. The level to which we are sinking is the animal level. Thought process, which is our basic character and which was allowing us to develop some sense as to how we can be happy, has become a casualty. It should be understood that happiness would never be derived unless we cherish and practice sacrifice and opt to serve. We can have enormous amount of pleasure but not happiness. Please note that only when we give no importance to thought and give importance to our existence, all alternative arguments take hold. There are what are called permanent values and temporary values. Today we are getting succumbed to the temporary values. Let us remind ourselves of the permanent values. Then yoga is possible, that is the union. God is not somewhere. God is not somewhere else to be found. You are He. It is the manifestation of God which is here. Call Him God, call Him energy, call Him base, or by any other name, because God has neither a name nor a form. Because if he was only one, which everyone agrees, so many people would not have described Him in so many ways. There cannot be a Hindu God, Muslim God, and Christian God, etc. As Reverend Babuji jokingly remarked in one of his conversations with some aspirants from the West, there is only one God who expresses Himself. We experience Him in so many ways because of the uniqueness of the union we have. In sadhana, everyone feels Him in a unique way, and so naturally He was expressed in so many ways. But everyone who has had experience of the union knows that it is the only thing. Everyone sticks on to his own experience because that is his experience. But he also knows that others can have the experience in their own way. Each one of us is an expression of the divine. This is the fundamental point of the system. If you kindly recall the basic roots, the Vedas.
Draw your attention. Like sir has brought a very, each one has got his experience in his own way, but each one knows that it is the same God which everybody is experiencing. Then the question is, if that is so, why there are so many differences even in the mission which was started by Babuji? So many people split after his passing away into several groups. Why is that happening? So we have can anybody give me the answer for that? Why people are breaking down and branching into their own things? Because each one, when he's meditating on the same God, and the mind is touching the same God, and he's convinced that he's feeling peaceful. And as sir says, he is also aware that other person who is meditating also feeling God in his own unique way. When that understanding is there, why there is splintering of groups happening?
Only that is because what Narayan sir says, everyone sticks on to his own experience because that is his own experience. But he also knows that others can have the experience in their own way. That particular second point is they are forgetting.
No. That only shows that he is broad-minded enough to know that others can know in his own way. But then there is a common thread of unity running in that statement, actually.
Yeah,
but
if he does not accept that others can have the experience in their own way, then he is differing from the other fellow and is splitting away.
But as for the science is, if anybody does the experiment, the result should be the same in any laboratory you do. And the mind is laboratory, and then when the mind is touching God, you get an experience. It should be, there's a common theme should be running, no? And then that common theme should be your unity. But why these splits are happening?
So it is basically, I feel, because of insistence that the way one experiences and the way one feels the path should be taken is more important than the others. It kind of boils down to ego, or you can say...
That is one correct way, but Babuji has himself answered.
We are not imbibing divine continuously. Only sometimes we imbibe divinity. That is why we are not able to get it.
That is one. But actually, I want anybody to quote what Babuji himself has said about this aspect. Anyway, I want some other answers.
What I feel is, in one of Revered Sir's articles, he has mentioned that when we do meditation, we experience that silence, but we are not happy to let that silence be that way. So we try to put in our shade. It's the same thing in this regard. We understand that the other person is getting the experience in his own unique way, but we are not happy with that. We want to validate every kind of experience in our own way. And that is where we are limiting the experience. I mean, correct. I'm not able to explain it properly.
You're correct. Anyway, the answer given by Babaji is very simple. He says, when we are living in the mind, each person's mind carries its own perception. And then, there'll be a difference of opinion when we are when the minds are involved. But we did a seminar, divinity can know divinity. We did a seminar on that. So when the mind moves into the divine plane, that means when the mind transcends beyond likes and dislikes, when the mind transcends nama rupa, physical form and the name. So that means when you are in established in Brahmanda consciousness, then in all the 23 people who are sitting, we will be talking the same language. There'll be no difference. What Babaji is talking, you'll be also talking the same thing. So from the divine plane, everybody will be talking the same language. There'll be no difference of opinion. But less than that individual plane, Pinda consciousness, that means when you have likes and dislikes, when you have... when you're still a lot of attachment to your body, attachment to your ideas, attachment to your network, then there will be difference of opinion. Once you move into the universal consciousness, which he talks in the 69 address, you know, the world peace is lacking. The problem is solved when the mind becomes universal in nature, then the problem. Once you move into universal consciousness, everybody will be talking the same thing. There'll be no difference of perception of a particular point. So that is the main idea. So suppose all of us have to move into universal consciousness, where you have transcended your ego, where you have transcended likes and dislikes. All of us will be talking same language, same thing. There'll be no difference of opinion there. But you are in the individual plane. Then you are colored by your perceptions. Colored, when I use the word colored, sir has beautifully spoken about what is colored in the Bhagavad Gita commentary he gave on the article of Babaji. So all of us are colored by our experiences, colored by our genetics, colored by our inheritance of spiritual or moral values, religious values, social values, food habits, all those things are inherited from the society, and then they color your thinking. But if you move into universal plane, the coloring is gone. So you will judge thing in a neutral way, in a detached way. And in a detached way, you don't project your likes and dislikes. You will be just judging it neutrally, as like a real judge, who he collects the evidence. And even though the other party member may be his close relative, he may still punish him because he is a neutral person there. At least when he is wearing that robe, he doesn't take sides. So you will be like that judge who will be not swayed by likes and dislikes, or if it is truth, you will stick to truth. You will be working in a detached manner. So there, truth is the same for everybody. Like anybody is meditating on divine light, when the mind touches divine light, everybody will feel calm. That is the truth which is felt by any human being on this earth. So there will be no difference of opinion on that point. But when you are in an individual plane, there will be differences of opinion. That is the important point. And as that is why if more people quickly move into universal consciousness, there will be more cohesion in the group. Group we can have very powerful impact in helping the world, human consciousness actually. Anyway, this I thought I should tell because...
The impressions color the experience.
Yes. No, that is only when you are in the
Pinda
consciousness. If you are in Pinda consciousness, there will be every opinion, there will be difference of the opinion. Anyway, we'll go ahead. Yes.
Each one of us is an expression of the divine. This is the fundamental point of the system. If you kindly recall the basic roots, the Vedas, which is also common for others, the Purusha sacrificed himself. The Purusha Medha is what the Purusha Sukta talks about. The Purusha sacrificed himself and he became many. Ekoham Bahushyam, which is what has happened. So one has multiplied into many. This was done by a process of sacrifice. Sacrifice is the principle of life. That is the main point for our living together, for our family systems. If you strike at the point of that sacrifice, then you are talking against the fundamental principles of manifestation. The roots of existence is questioned. The present day enthusiasts advocating the concept of independency and the capacity to stand on one's own way, on one's own, may well remember this. If energy remained what it was and did not explode either through a big bang or through any theory explaining creation or evolution or any other theory any one of us might have, there would have been no universe and naturally we would not be here. But every one of these ideas could have actually happened, and each one is possible because none of us know what happened. Which is why practical people do not talk about this. The richness of your life is not dependent upon the abstract theories of Big Bang, Sankhya, Bergson's theory of creative evolution, or any other theories. These will not give you any solution. They will give you only information at best. Please note that there is a lot of difference between information and jnana. Incidentally, I will take a small digression. There is something called information. Processed information becomes knowledge, but knowledge does not become understanding. This can be otherwise called in the ancient term wisdom. Up to the point of knowledge, it is covered by the process of cognition. The second part, that is called understanding, is connected with cognition or feeling. Everybody knows that it is necessary to understand that we are brothers and sisters, but none of us feel it. Knowledge regarding the same has been given, but due to lack of feeling, there is no understanding. Without feeling, no understanding is possible. The above comes only by experience. Psychology, as is presently known, is nothing but animal psychology, which has undergone a transition over a period of time.
The cognition descends into the feeling, then when the feeling is there, you don't have to force your mind to behave in a particular manner. It will be natural. So like people have a caste feeling, it is there in people, and even though they know that that fellow is a criminal, is a murderer, they just vote for him because it is natural for him to identify himself with the caste group or something like that. So if your feeling of fraternal feeling is established in the heart, you will very normally and naturally behave in a fraternal feeling with other brethren. So the my point from the neuroscience perspective is only this, that if you hold a particular thought of the divine light or Babaji Maharaj in your mind for 1 hour at least, and that will remodel your subconscious mind, and that feeling becomes your background actually. And that will help you to become compassionate and friendly towards everybody in a natural way, because that feeling will now color your perceptions and color your thinking. So the more sincerely you practice and hammer this thought into your subconscious mind by holding this thought as long as possible with a determination in a relaxed way, then the background feeling will be there, and then that causes divinization, and that causes transformation, and that causes yoga or union. So that is important. So it's directly proportional to the quality of time and quality of practice you're doing, and holding the thought of the master without any distraction. A distraction means even gross distraction, and subtle distractions also should not be there. If they are there, then the influence of the mind to create that feeling in the subconscious mind will not be so great actually. I'm trying to hammer this point because
yeah,
it will help people to practice with more determination and more intention and more result-oriented thing. You should, if you think of a master, you must also think of moving back to the home. You should try to reach him and be in him, not just think and leave it there. When you think, you should think of going back to the source actually. So that will come only when the feeling starts developing. We'll go ahead, sir.
Psychology, as is presently known, is nothing but animal psychology, which has undergone a transition for a period of time. The present day psychology is without feeling. It talks about ways of knowing and not ways of understanding. Yoga is a way of understanding, not a way of knowing. This is the fundamental difference. Why I would like to stress this is most of us who have meditated or trying to meditate now will have our own experience. We'll see something, we'll hear something, and then we will comment that this is our experience. The point here is that we are literally trying to molest our feeling to fit into a language of knowledge. We are not happy with our understanding and are trying to bring it down to the level of knowledge, even if necessary by sacrificing certain details, and then start saying we are not satisfied with it as it does not correspond with what someone else has stated. Language of feeling is what we will have to learn in order to feel the union. Everybody knows that we are expression of the divine. Without energy, we are not here. Without energy, there is no solar system. Without solar system, we do not have planets, and correspondingly, not no life. Each one of us has got information that sun is the source and earth is the base. But we do not feel this. Earlier people felt it, but did not have the knowledge. Nowadays, people have the knowledge, but lack the capacity to feel. The union cannot be understood unless we learn to feel. The language of feeling has to be learned. Don't try to bring in whatever little experience during your meditation to fit into our knowledge process, but try to understand it as it is. Try to appreciate a flower as it is. By trying to separate the petals and analyzing it, we may gain botanical knowledge, but that will not give us understanding. The beauty of a flower lies in the way it is. The beauty of existence lies in the way we are. Don't try to feel ashamed in front of somebody else, because God has created each one of us and He is in each one of us. When we know the purpose of the sacrifice He has done, the happiness He wanted us to have, then we understand the sun that shines every day. That is the nature of life. The nature of life is sacrifice, and through sacrifice, be happy. Ishavasimidam sarvam yat kincha jagatyam jagat. Tena taktena bunjita ma grahata kasya svidhanam. So says Isha Upanishad. This means that the entire universe is His. Therefore, getting detached, be happy. Covet not somebody else's. This is the only mantra that is repeated in all the four Vedas and finds place in the Upanishads. The main point to note is everywhere there is God. Therefore, do not try to possess anything. Possessing not, enjoy and be happy. What is it that has made us come to this level of not understanding this fundamental? What is the problem with us? The problem was identified even in the mantra with the word tena chaktena, which means don't own anything. That is, there is a tendency to own up everything and cling to it as if it were our own. The truth, nothing is ours. And everything belongs to God, who pervades everything in the universe. But we have started owning up things and people as if they are ours forever. In the language of Revered Babuji, there is undue attachment with us for everything or person that we consider our own. While due attachment is necessary to perform our duty efficiently, undue attachment leads to generation of bondage and fetters. We came here as an expression of the divine, but we started thinking that everything is due to our action. We started feeling that we are the doers, and it is we who are doing good or bad to others. Neither are we the persons to do good, nor are we the persons to kill. That is the solution in the Bhagavad Gita. The greatest message which is given in the Gita is that we are not the doers. Lord Krishna says to Arjuna, I am the doer and you are the only means or the instrument. That Arjuna has to be only as nimitta matram, being just nominally present. For just his purposes as nimitta matram, he goes on sending streams of individuals into the world in various lines. Because the very nature of life is that it will decay or perish. To keep going his creation, he sends somebody else to replace. There is perenniality of flow, which again is subject to the principle of procreation. The maintaining job of creation is only through procreation, but meaningful procreation, meaningful tradition, and a meaningful principle that is transmitted is the divine light. When we try to possess something and say it is our own, we are forming an impression in us which may otherwise be called as samskaras, which even when we tend to forget, it remains as a vasana with us. Among people who try to get rid of some bad habits, though they make a decision to get rid of it and do get rid of it, the misfortune is the vasana is still there, and when circumstances of stress, circumstances of loneliness, circumstance of company are not suitable for you to de-addict yourself, there is a recurrence. Vasana is present there due to the samskaras made already by you. Nobody gives us samskaras. We make our own samskaras. And samskaras arise out of attachment to work. That is why every great saint has been telling us to detach ourselves from desires and action. Unless we develop detachment or vairagya, we are not going to progress further. we cannot progress in spirituality towards sharing unless you develop vairagya. Anything, Madhava?
Fine, sir. Unless somebody wants clarifications, somebody wants some comments. Very clear. It is, sir has spent so much of time and to explain, you know, these are all subtle points which come to our understanding in deep meditation. But he is trying to help us, you know, Attipandu Olichipettinattu, he is trying to help make the job easy for us.
It's very, you put it in a very simple way for us to understand. Yeah.
He's putting it in a platter to you and giving it to you.
Yes.
Sir, there are two different sentences which came that everything belongs to Brahman and everything is Brahman.
Kidare, where is that? Isavasyam Sarvamidam.
So we need to look at everything. Is everything belongs to him?
Babaji also totally agrees to the principle of Advaita. Actually, if you go deeply into his philosophy and all that, he just says there is a very minor difference between God and a human being who has achieved a very high degree of negation, but it is very nominal, it is hardly anything, he says. So in a way, it is a kind of a Advaita which Shankara is talking. That means everything is made up of God only. Even the thoughts which are arising in me or arising in you or in the billions of people who are existing on this planet, in the several planets, is a form of God only. So so even in our meditation, we have these conditions transitioning. You know, I am Brahman, everything is Brahman and all from Brahman. So these feelings keep on changing. The truth is that there is a unity only, unity of everything. And the mind, because of the theory of Leela and all that, believes that it is separate from God. But belief doesn't make it the truth. So when we meditate, this understanding dawns on us and then we become quiet actually. And then the problem is solved. But the truth is everything is God only, in various forms of God.
So it's merely a play of our mind that they appear as?
Mind, it is the different people, the Advaita people talk it as a bhranti. It's an illusion, they say, you know. And now modern neuroscience people are also talking of illusion only, in the sense the brain actually interprets the data and then projects a picture in front of you or an idea in front of you. Now sound waves are coming in my ears and then my mind, because of past association and all that, will recollect the memory from that, and the brain actually interprets and says it is Atul Sharma's voice, Atul Mishra's voice. Like that, the brain interprets and then projects that interpretation into my consciousness. So it is nobody can know the reality as such. So actually, it is all a projection by the interpretation of the brain onto the consciousness, and consciousness is there's no limit, unlimited, and it is subtler than space also. So that is the general idea now. So finally, when you realize it looks very silly and it's so simple, and you get an idea that you have been fooled all this time unnecessarily, going through this journey of suffering. That's the idea one gets when you realize that this is all a game, and then you've been taken for a nasty ride by nature or whatever you may think. But actually, it is very simple. It's uh, the, the it is as simple. The Sakshi is there. Like now I'm talking to you. While I'm talking, I'm aware that I'm talking to you. I'm aware that you are listening. And I'm aware my thoughts arising in my mind and my vocal cords pronouncing the sound. But the awareness is actually the God, actually. The same awareness is present in you and all the listeners here, and it is present in the space between also. And there are several realities existing in that awareness. So good and bad, or beautiful and ugly, everything, they remain in that awareness. And in meditation, a stage comes when you suddenly understand that God has been always there with you, and then you simply missed him. How you'll be surprised how you could miss such a very obvious phenomena, actually. So when that comes, it's a kind of a liberation, actually. And then the more you tend to take refuge in that awareness, the more your mind starts getting molded towards that reality. And then molding is the time. Molding actually takes time. But these experiences of feeling the presence of God, all of us have, but we do not value it so much, and we do not try to take refuge in that feeling the presence of the Master, actually. So in that sense, if you see, we have to perfectly agree with Babuji that realization is a very simple thing. It can be, it is so easy. He says, turn your head and then it is as near as the jugular vein, or, you know, pick up a needle with your fingers. It's as simple as that. But solution to the problem of life, if you listen to his talk, he says, but due to complicated thinking, man has created complexities. He talks like that. So it, truly speaking, it is within our plain sight, but we have just missed it. And if you move into that, if you meditate with the feeling of plainness and simplicity and humbleness and reverence, suddenly you can get access to that, and then you can enjoy in that presence, actually. I don't know. I don't know what question Atul has put. It is a philosophical question, but then Advaita, the God is one. Yeah, finally, unity feeling is when you meditate, you become one with God. You do not know who is God and who is you. Both those things merge. Actually, yoga means samadhi only. Samadhi means the meditating consciousness. When it is meditating on the consciousness of Babaji Maharaj or consciousness of divine light without luminosity, they both become one. You cannot say who is Babaji and who is Atul Mishra or something. It fuses into one. And then the questioner also simply disappears. Atul, aapka question theek se samjha?
Yes, I got answered. Yeah, I got my answer.
Recently, Sister Bhargavi has sent a Vyamana Padyam, if you remember.
Yes, sir.
Recently, Sister Bhargavi has sent a Vyamana Padyam.
Vyamana, na?
Yeah, he says, the meaning of it is that it's like somebody who has got butter in his hand and is looking for a ghee.
Okay.
It's like searching for the God. It is there already in the butter. Only thing is that you have to make it into ghee. That is the sadhana you have to do.
Okay. It's already ghee is there in that butter.
Yes.
Already there. That's
already right. There. Only with sadhana you can find him.
Yeah, that's right.
So the ghee in the butter, you have to make out with your sadhana.
So the final point is, sir, which everybody should grasp is that final point, if you want to succeed in meditation, your meditation should lead to humility and surrender. You're moving in the direction of surrender. So I keep on repeating the same thing. What Babaji himself has said is the best way to surrender is to create a state of mind where you feel dependence on Master always. It is very easy to practice dependence, but you cannot practice surrender, because if you try to practice surrender, ego will get strengthened again and again. whereas you can practice dependency. Now you can just simply sit here, and now I'm sitting, and then I feel that I am an instrument depending on the master, and then master is the force. I am drawing energy from him. So if I think like that and I'm depending on him, if I think that whatever thought is coming in my mind and whatever feeling is coming, suppose I have some discomfort or suppose I'm having a peaceful state of mind, that is all coming from the master, and it is, and you don't want to that state to disappear, or you want something better, better state to come to your mind. Suppose you expect some better calmness, or you want that some discomfort in your body should go away. That means it is not dependency. So that can be very easily practiced. You just have to accept whatever is existing in your mind as the right thing to happen at this moment. And you should not wish that the thing should change, or whatever change is coming, you should accept it as a gift of God. So that is, in another way, you can think that that is a state of contentment that can be practiced. And if he says, if you practice in this way, surrender happens, because the God's attention will be on you directly. And because of his grace, surrender happens, and then you've finished your job. Then only you will be just trying to, your presence is a gift for the universe, and then you'll be helping other people to enjoy peace and happiness. Bill, go ahead, sir.
No, brother Srikant Mahajan has sent a question. Is what? Maya a trap created by God to test us, or is it an illusion or delusion because of our samskara or mind?
No, I want Srikant to study Babuji's work. He has written about Maya in Eighth Commandment. Let him read that. So yeah, Babuji has very clearly given his views about Maya. Each person has to do homework. Without that, you know, it cannot be spoon-fed.
Yeah, basically, you cannot separate Maya from divine.
No, I know. Chepped
ga. Same. Yeah.
So each person, when they're reading, they should pay some attention. They should be pay attention and read and try to contemplate and think about it. It should not be just for pastime. You should not put a question, because it's already been
answered
by Babaji himself. So you have to read it and then try to understand it. And it is not difficult. All of us have got the capacity to understand. There are simple things only which we can understand.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Detachment, it has been always stated by saints and others who have practiced spiritual life, is possible only when we are in a hopeless position, so as to feel we are not capable of doing anything. The traditional methods which have been given to achieve this or fasting, diksha, yatra, be away from the family, all of which are desperate solutions, because everybody understood that unless one detaches himself physically from the environment, it is not possible to progress. For one in Grihastha Ashrama, it was said to be impossible to attain realization or Brahmajnana. Detachment is necessary to get rid of the samskaras and vasanas. Unless samskaras and vasanas are removed, it is not possible to move towards chetta and bunjita. But annihilation of self is the basic point for us. Union is the goal. And what is the union? Feeling the presence of divinity, which has given us the life, and continue the tradition which he has given. And then what is the tradition God has given us? Sacrifice in order for others' happiness, other person's happiness. Purusha Sukta clearly tells that Purusha Medha, the sacrifice of the Purusha, that is God, was meant for expressing his happiness in his expression, namely creation, in which human being occupies the topmost position. That means the divine meant happiness for all of us. So if we want to achieve that principle or character of life, and we want to have the union, all other goals take lesser priority. It is to be noted that the union sought for is not to become one with the ultimate. The goal is to express the ultimate and to sacrifice one's interest to such an extent that there is happiness all around, in which we are also included. When we try to give happiness, we cannot help but get included And the analogy of the candle does not hold well in this respect. A candle always throws a shadow below itself. And the shadow, if we take it as detachment, then it is all right. But if you take it as the nature of light itself, it is not proper. The candle is meant to give light to others. It incidentally casts a shadow down immediately below, but that shadow is not the nature of the candle. The candle is happy giving light to others through a continuous process of sacrificing its existence. It is able to emanate and generate happiness, light for others, and so does the sun. Therefore, it is God. He is God because he makes us live. The sun dies every second so that we may live. If we remove sun, then we cease to exist. So, feeling the presence of divinity or reaching the goal of yoga is to see that happiness is spread and we are happy. As Reverend Babuji puts it in his commandments, we should be in a position to mold our living so as to rouse a feeling of love and piety in others. We live in such a way so that others also feel love and piety towards God. Any other goal does not have any meaning at all for our life. The union with the Absolute does not have any meaning at all. The people of West who did not have the advantage of the spiritual culture of this land started interpreting this as pessimism. The people of our land are most optimistic. We are very courageous and tolerant. Which tolerance and sacrifice has been interpreted as pessimism? It takes enormous courage to welcome an unknown guest, taking him to be our God, and treat him with utmost respect, and share first with him whatever we have. We take our share only after he is satisfied. Further, we have enormous confidence that even if we commit a series of mistakes, we are not condemned, and that we are going to have another chance to rectify. The natural order puts everything in its proper place. The natural order is to share, sacrifice, live together, cooperate, and tolerate. We are born into this order and we live in this order. This is possible only when we feel the union, when we feel attached to something as our own and start having our own creation. There is a conflict between our creation and the God's creation. They do not go together. He wants service and sacrifice, whereas we tend to want possessiveness and selfishness. Please note that all the great asuras who have been mentioned in our Puranas knew enough about all our gods. They were capable of making the gods come to them and get boons, which is not possible without having some merit in them. The problem they had was possessiveness. Possessiveness is the problem of a person who knows but does not yield. Instead of yielding, he tries to possess. The problem here is that we tend to start feeling that we are the doer. You are not the doer. God is the doer. You are but a nimitta matra. That is what Lord Krishna said in the Gita. If we are not going to yield to the divine, divinity will find its own means of getting things done. Opportunities are always given for rectification. If we do not rectify ourselves now, there is always a next life.
It's a very long article, sir. We have to split it into two sessions or three sessions. I don't know how many pages we have covered.
We might be halfway right now.
Yeah, but we will, the important points are there. Can anybody summarize all the important points that sir has mentioned in this article so far? Dharmesh, can you make an attempt to summarize what all?
Okay.
What all we have read and what are the main take-home points you have been able to remember from reading this article so far?
So one thing is, he starts with jnana and vairagya and says the vairagya is the main jnana. So that is the first thing. And then from that, coming to in terms of how do we practice Vairagya in terms of the detachment, and the other thing is attachment to God. It would mean that everything is His. That is the first thing, so that we are not possessing. And then we get into the feeling that everything is Him. So these are the two things I got. And then there are a lot other details. And after Vairagya, talking about the sacrifice, and the sacrifice is the main part of life, or the main quality. And where the example that is given is in terms of the family, and how the earlier family system, joint family system, has come to the nuclear family, and the, how the value of sacrifice is slowly going away. But the more we are developing the spirituality, the more we will have the quality of sacrifice. So these are the...
Anybody else wants to fill up the gaps of this article written?
Some other things in the beginning, which I have missed.
You can hold on. Let other people also contribute to what...
One thing I would just fill in is that the main thing is to, you know, all these thoughts or whatever of sharing and all those things has to boil down to the level of feeling for it to be deep-rooted in us in order to bring out the transformation.
A very important point. You see, this we should not miss from his article. Feeling is more important than thinking. So yoga is a method by which your knowledge or information you had becomes an understanding and feeling. So that is very important point he has mentioned. Anything else?
Yeah, that's what yoga is a way of understanding and not just knowing.
Feeling important. We should remember that and try to develop this faculty of feeling actually. Any other important point? Isa Vasya Sarvam Idam, that is also important. Tiena Tyaktiena Gunjita Magrada Kasya Vidhanam. This is a very famous Upanishad, and this simple Upanishad, if people study, especially if statesmen in the world study, there will be no wars at all. All wars can stop instantly. Because everything is God, so... all the wars in the world are due to hegemony. You want to conquer your neighbor's land and wealth and all this thing, and you want all your other people to be your slaves and all that. So you want everything, you want to possess everything. So all wars and empires were built with the idea of Alexander started his campaign, he wanted to conquer the world. The Mughals conquered, the Turks conquered, the Romans conquered. In the name of religion, the Christians in these things. Conquering is what you want to possess things. And all the misery of humanity is facing is because of this possessive tendency. If the world statements, the United Nations, if this Isa Vasya Sarvamidam is explained to them, instantly wars can stop. This is a very beautiful Upanishad, actually.
I also understood that as long as we are constrained with our thoughts, or our attention is based on ourselves, we will not be able to get into those feelings of divinity, like what Sir has mentioned.
Yeah.
Or we cannot live in a family.
That is what we are trying to do in yoga. What we are trying to, basically when we are meditating, your mind is now shifting its focus away from ourselves to God actually. So you're practicing, you're training your mind to think about God and not about yourself, not about your problems, not about your desires and wishes and all that. So It is a beginning of the method to wean away the mind from attachment to our physical body, attachment to our desires, attachment to our aversions, and attachment to our families and relatives and property, all these things are against the law of nature. That is not the truth, actually. But truth is, we are divine in nature and we should express our divine nature. And then sir brings out a very powerful point of sacrifice. And so if you imitate God in the form of sacrifice, then you will get into harmony with your true divine nature. And meditation is the beginning of that process where you try to decondition the clutter which you have collected in our mind in the form of our own creation or the form network. And we are all trapped in that network. And meditation is a process where you are trying to escape from that network and destroy that network so that you regain your freedom of an infinite being, of a infinite being who's got true peace. I mean, it's not a conditional peace. Conditional peace, even when you're thinking about meditation, many times you must have experienced extraordinary degree of joy and peace in your mind. But they come and go. But if you move into a homeland, that will be uncorrupted and of a very high quality, and then uninterrupted peace will, that's called bliss, actually. So that is the aim of meditation. The aim of the meditation is to have a bliss which you can't, nobody can take it away from you. But this bliss which we are now getting when our mind is touching the thoughts of the master, can go away if we divert our mind away into some mundane functions like seeing your emails or seeing news or whatever it is, we lose it. But then we don't want to lose it. And then if you don't lose it, then that is true freedom, actually. So meditation is a technique to get liberated from our the prisons which we have built ourselves, actually.
So sir has given several examples, based on this. And he said, you yield. If you do not yield, you can always have a next life. He has brought out a powerful sentence there.
No, that is actually the beauty of Hinduism is that only, no? Whereas Abrahamic faiths like Christianity, Islam and Judaism, they feel that there's only one life, and then if your life is over, then you're buried there, and then till the day of resurrection, you'll be buried. So people have a lot of pessimism in Western countries because they know they have got only one life. Whatever your desires are there, you must try to enjoy it. Suppose you get a disease and you die, then you lost all opportunities. So the lot of depression and pessimism or suffering, psychological suffering, adhyatmika suffering is in the Western countries is because of the nature of the philosophy behind the religion itself. Whereas Hinduism talks about rebirth and all that. And if you listen to the story of Harishchandra, then you will know. You know, Harishchandra was, he didn't have any children at all. So then he prays to Lord Kubera or something. And then he gets a boon that he'll get a child, but on one condition, that he should give the child as soon as he's born. But when the time comes, he keeps on postponing it. Finally, when the child achieves the age of 16, he'll ask him to run away from the home so that he can avoid the responsibility. And then he was cursed also. And then later in the next session, there was a meeting amongst the gods that to perform a certain function, they should find only the honest person on the earth. And the gods mentioned the name of Raja Harishchandra. And immediately Vishwamitra says, no, I don't agree with him. He was a liar of the first order. So he's not fit to do that sacrifice. And then, but the gods say, no, he's transformed after the experience in the previous life. Now he's under all circumstances, he'll speak the truth. So with a vengeance, Vishwamitra puts him to lots of tests, but then he comes out with flying colors. And then that story gives us the idea that even the worst person can become a god. Hinduism gives you that optimism, actually. He may be a Rakshasa or a Pishacha, but then if he thinks if he makes a decision that he wants to enjoy the company of God and reach that homeland, no force can stop him. And so that is the beauty of the Hindu philosophy, Hindu way of life, where, you know, everybody has a chance to evolve and then reach the blissful nature, which is a person's real nature. So that is one. So whereas Western Abrahamic religions, a person can play only one innings. Suppose by mistake he lost his concentration, he gets bored, finish. He lost all opportunities. Whereas here you can have several innings, and then you keep on developing in each. You correct your mistakes, keep on evolving. Evolution, you know, the demands of evolution are a lot of scope. Actually, Hinduism is the truth. They're all primitive religion meant for barbaric tribes, actually. So that's it. Any other important point you have missed in the article so far, which will serve as it is a educational thing. We are trying to remember you are trying to go for an exam. You want to not miss important points and fail in the exam. So we try to take the important points which sir has given. It will help the whole group.
So one of the points which important point that he begins with is like sharing and sacrifice as a principle to be felt and followed is not possible unless you develop vairagya. So that concept of due attachment has to be developed using our thought. That is one of the early points that comes out in this message. And then he has stressed the importance of sharing and service, and then how that has been glorified in our culture.
Yeah.
And then the other thing is that story of mongoose, right? Like, I hope everyone knows that. We have included that in our moral stories also.
Padmajagari, mongoose story students tell together?
అది తెలుసు సాక్రిఫైస్ లో ఒక మంగూస్ హాఫ్ గోల్డెన్ మంగూస్ స్టోరీ కూడా తెలుసు యా యా దెన్
సో దట్ ఈస్ ఆల్సో లైక్ ఇంపార్టెంట్ స్టోరీ ఫర్ ఆల్ ఆఫ్ us టు రీడ్ లైక్ యుధిష్ఠిర ఇస్ కన్సిడర్డ్ ఎన్ ఎపిటోమ్ ఆఫ్ ధర్మ రైట్ బట్ స్టిల్ హి కమిట్స్ ద మిస్టేక్ ఆఫ్ ఫీలింగ్ ప్రైడ్ దట్ హి ఇస్ డూయింగ్ అ గ్రేట్ థింగ్ బై డూయింగ్ దిస్ యజ్ఞ అండ్ దెన్ he's actually doing a lot of sacrifice. Yeah. Until he's humbled by this mongoose.
Yeah.
So that is one unsaid lesson for us, that we shouldn't think when we do our sadhana and then we are praying for others that we are like doing some great thing. It's just part of our duty, and it's that humility and humbleness should be maintained by all abhyasis.
Yeah.
So that is one thing which, if you read that mongoose story, we'll understand. Because that simple teacher who points out the value of sacrifice, his sacrifice is much greater. So that one point, that our sacrifice should be at the point of self-deprivation. Only then it is considered sacrifice. So many times, at least we were, I will say that for myself, that we used to think of ourselves as great people who are now sacrificing our time this thing. But humility has to be maintained even in that attempt, because it is essentially the master who enables us to do these things. So that story is good, because we have been telling children. I thought everyone should also.
All adults should know it. It's an important story. Yeah. Anyway, if I beg your freedom to read two letters written by Babaji, which may be useful to. They're two pages. This is from Voice Real. I just want to read so that, you know, it may be. After that, we'll end this session. So one of the letter goes like this. This is because I'm reading this, because there's an important practical point here. create in yourself the feeling that God on whom you are meditating is attracting you or pulling you towards himself. Those people who are meditating on divine light in their heart, as I have told them to do, should also keep this in mind. Inverted commas. Divine light which is in my heart is pulling me towards him. Unquote. Then you people can see how devotion and love are produced. This much is necessary. That is an important point. All of you can practice this straight away. Next, he says, I shall say that you should also create attachment. It is the essential duty of a devotee. Saintliness or humanism is in this alone, that one's duty is completed. One whose vision does not penetrate into himself is not a human being. Therefore, the real search is in our vision always being within us only. If an Abhyasi practices this, that is keeping his vision within himself, his condition will be there only. That is, in our main storehouse, the real storehouse, we establish our mark. Then what remains to be done is our own expansion. Now, how are we going to expand ourselves? For this, whatever I'm telling you here is part of this practice. That is, along with meditation on God, also make an effort to go inside yourself. It is very easy for human beings, including all householders, to follow the things that I am saying, if they have the restlessness to attain God. If God produces true restlessness in people, and let us pray that it happens, it does not take long to attain it. People are in search of peace. So who is ready for the uncomfortable feeling of restlessness? I can vouchsafe that the joy that is in this restlessness, that is in constant remembrance of God, is not there in peace. In my understanding, in reality, real peace is a marvelous thing and something that comes with spiritual maturity. Its refuge is surely obtained in practice. Refuge is temporarily what we are feeling. We feel, many times we feel for several minutes or hours, peaceful condition of mind, a joyful condition. And he is talking of that joy and that peace which comes when you know the grace of God is falling on us. He says that is a refuge of the real peace, is not this thing. Its refuge is surely obtained in practice. Whoever gives the proof for this certainly has an important role. As restlessness grows and reaches its limit and then crosses that limit, then real peace begins. To write anything more about this would be a waste. The purpose behind my writing this is merely to convey the concept that if people become restless to reach God, in this alone, I shall have peace. If you people consider that in return for whatever service I'm doing, I should have peace, then the only remedy is that you consider it as your duty to be restless. Of course, this was also reflected in the Tinsukya message. But the point I'm trying to say is, he says, think that the divine light in my heart is attracting me towards it. He says, you should have this feeling, actually. If you take the word of Sir's today's main idea about feeling, you have to cultivate this feeling. And then when this feeling comes, he says, it's very fast you will develop love and devotion. If nothing else, then we'll meet next time.